Welcome to Nugget 159 with Steve Grohman. And today we are returning to the Petrified Forest National Park in eastern Arizona. If you haven't watched Nugget 158, we want to encourage you to go back because that is part one, and now for part two.
We'll pick up again with this booklet. It says, humans have passed through and lived in this sun-struck land for a very long time, perhaps as long as 10,000 years ago. Not Paleo-Indians and then archaic people lived off the land, hunting big game, and then turning to smaller prey such as cottontail rabbits and prairie dogs.
Oh.
They ate them?
Prairie dogs are so cute.
They are cute. We should throw a picture of those guys in here. They're cute. The greens and seeds of tansy mustard and rice grass also added to their diets.
We should probably add that to our diets.
We should probably add that to our diets. That's a good idea. Later folk settled down to grow corn, first living in pit houses, then building above ground structures of sandstone slabs and blocks of petrified wood, such as Puerco Pueblo, and agate house, excavated sites open to visitors. Generations of people left catalogs of their lives on burnished boulders. Some of these petroglyphs are symbols that appear to have been deliberately positioned as markers of summer solstice and other significant celestial events.
And we have been to many petroglyph sites, and if you haven't been to one, I definitely encourage you to do that. It's actually really, really cool. And as this sign said, whispers from the past. For thousands of years, indigenous people have used rock faces as a means of communication. Petroglyphs are images, symbols, or designs scratched, pecked, carved, or incised on the surface of the rocks. Here are some samples of that. But at this one particular one, what is extremely interesting is this. This one was the one that really intrigued us. It was entitled Summer Solstice Marker. And they want you to tell us about the summer solstice and how this marker worked.
One of the things that I say, actually, in our Misconceptions About Space lesson is, and also in the six-day lesson, because God made the sun, moon, and stars. He made the greater light and the lesser light, and he made those stars also, but he put them there for times and for seasons, for days and years. He put them there as markers. And what's interesting, people have heard of Stonehenge. We have that kind of thing, actually, all over this country, several different places we've seen. But here's an example of one of them where there's a cleft in that rock that at the same time of the year, every year, the sun is exactly in the same spot. Well, that's been that way for thousands and thousands of years, which is fascinating.
It says here, a solstice is an astronomical event that happens twice annually as the sun reaches its highest and lowest points in the sky. Here in the Northern Hemisphere, June 20th is usually the longest day of the year and is referred to as the summer solstice. And it shows that these photographs illustrate how the sunlight from the rising summer solstice sun flows down the cleft in the boulder in front of you, and the play of light and shadows on the spiral petroglyph changes as the sun rises and moves across the sky. From between June 14th
to the 28th,
a shaft of light forms, moving down the side of the adjacent boulder until it touches the center of the spiral within a few minutes of 9 a.m. And look, when we were there, guys, June 18th, 2020 at 12:45 p.m. I was like jumping up and down going, I cannot believe that we're missing this. But we did get to see, you can see the cleft in the rock, and you can see the spiral on there. But I'm sure it was going to be occurring soon, but we weren't able to hang around. That was really extra special.
It is exciting.
So close to the actual event. And that's what the people there used.
That's what the farm, well, not that, just that, but things like that and that are used. That's why the Farmer's Almanac works.
Right. And we talked to Mike from New Mexico several nuggets back, and he kept bringing up how, as farmers, they used the seasons in the sky.
Right, right. And it's not occultic, or it's not witchcraft, or it's not anything like that. It's what God said they're for. They're for times and for seasons, for days and years, and they are doing exactly what he told them to do. It's fascinating.
And then we ran across this sign that said the new Pangaea, and we talk about Pangaea specifically in Lesson 12, Questions and Answers, where we specifically answer in number 9, what about Pangaea? But as far as this sign, they had some crazy statements on this sign.
During the Triassic era, all the continents were joined together as one landmass called Pangaea. Since that time, they have scattered across the globe. Now our continents are joined together again by our intricate trade routes. Humans are spreading plants, animals, and diseases from one continent to another at a rate unobserved for millions of years.
They know that how? And thank you. That sounds like we're awful.
Yeah, right. Well, minimization of humanity. We've covered that.
They just have to cut down mankind, don't they?
They do. And it says, though trade routes are vital to our economic well-being, they are influencing the health of native species even in remote places like Petrified Forest National Park. Roads, rails, flight routes accelerate the spread of exotic species while at the same time they hinder the movement of native animals trying to migrate and to adapt to changing climate.
It's just a political slant, isn't it?
And politically correct stuff right there, is it not?
This sign had several silly things on it, but one of them was just kind of sad, I guess. It's islands on land. Studies of radio-collared pronghorn show that they do not cross the railroad tracks even when fences are removed. It's as if they were trapped on islands, and that reminded me of Piggy.
Yeah, she didn't move once we took the hot wire down. She still knew that was her limit.
Steve had a pig, and then he removed the hot wire, and she would not go.
She would not go past that spot. And she was 980 pounds. She was monstrous. Couldn't force her to go either.
And here's the trail to the Long Logs and Agate House that we had mentioned before, and some pictures of the Agate House and the Long Logs.
We definitely want to encourage people, if you travel and you do head out west, some of these places, well, anywhere, look at our nuggets, and they're just absolutely incredible places to go see and things to see and issues to learn, things to learn, people to learn about.
And here is the park map. Here is an example. This is the Giant Logs Trail Guide. This is one of the last trails on the southern part of the park and has a whole guide. And they have inside there, they have this old geologic column, but they also have at stop six is Old Faithful. And it says this giant of giant logs measures 35 feet long and weighs approximately 44 tons. Previously called names like the Monarch and Major Domo, this impressive log has been a favorite visitor attraction for years. In the late 1920s, the park superintendent's wife said the log was to Petrified Forest what the Old Faithful geyser is to Yellowstone National Park. From this, the name Old Faithful stuck. I want you to look at this picture. And Steve, tell them who this is in this picture.
You talking about Albert Einstein?
I'm talking about Albert Einstein.
Albert Einstein.
He and his wife posed by this rock.
Posed by it.
March 1st of 1931. We're no Einstein, but we went ahead and took our mug by that famous
rock. That's right, we did. It's fun.
Besides the petroglyphs, some of the other American history there is the Route 66, which crosses along the north side of the park. And if you're interested in Route 66, I want to encourage you to watch my Saturday Travel and History Tips. And specifically, the Petrified Forest is in the Route 66 series, part number 3. This is the Blue Mesa, and it is part of what are they call exposed teepees there at the park. And they have found fossils of rhino-like animals in these teepees, in this dirt here. So it's quite an incredible park, and you can walk everywhere. You can walk up to these teepees.
You can take your picnic lunch in there.
Yes, you can.
Sit right there and eat. But once again, you can see the evidence of the flood in those strata layers that are like that. Moving water is the only thing that can lay that type of thing down. We have evidence all over.
And it's just exceedingly gorgeous above all of that.
It is that.
All right. Well, thank you.